Hi, my name is Megan, and I'm a teacher here at Treehouse. My pronouns are she, her, hers. In this course, I'll teach you how to work with Flask, a popular Python framework for creating websites or web applications. A framework is a collection of code that makes building something easier. Flask will help us to create a website. Because it has written a lot of the code for us, we just need to learn how to use these new tools. Flask helps us work with the request-response cycle. Let's take a look at what that means. The application gets requests, which are people on the internet asking for information from our application. Once they get to our application, it looks at all the routes available and figures out which function to call. A lot of people call these functions controllers, but they can also be called views. The view then sends back a response, which can be HTML or JSON or XML. A user requests information from your site. Your site determines how to handle the request and what information to send back. And then a response is sent to the user. So when a user asks for Treehouse's homepage, the site will receive the request and send back the homepage's information. Together, we're going to create this pet adoption website using Flask, SQLAlchemy, HTML, and CSS. It will hold a list of pets available for adoptions. Users will also have the ability to add, edit, and delete. As we go along, feel free to play around with the site's colors and structure to make it your own. For this project, you can follow along in Workspaces. It already has Flask installed, and I have attached them to the videos moving forward. If you would like to follow along locally, you will need to install Flask. I would also suggest creating a virtual environment to practice a typical workflow. First, I created a new project folder called Adoption Flask Project, and I opened it inside of my IDE. I'm using Visual Studio, but please use whichever IDE or integrated development environment you feel comfortable with. You can find links to two favorites in the teacher's notes. Once I opened it, I can navigate to the terminal and create a virtual environment by running Python 3-m. venv. On a Windows computer, you may not need this 3 here at the end of Python. I'm on a Mac, so I am going to use it. You can see it created my environment folder, and Visual Studio is like, hey, you created a virtual environment. Do you want to use it? And yes, we do. We definitely want to use it. Awesome. Now I need to activate the environment by running. On Windows, you would do .env/scripts, and then activate. If you're on a Mac, like I am, then you do source, and then you do /, as opposed to /, environment bin activate. So make sure to use the one that works for your machine. They're also listed in the teacher's notes just in case. So I'm going to go ahead and do that. And you can see it's activated now because I have this environment here at the beginning of my command prompt. Okay, so now we have our environment activated. Let's install Flask. We'll use pip install Flask. Awesome. And to make sure that it got installed, we can do pip freeze caret to the right requirements.txt. Hit enter and it'll create that requirements.txt file here. And you can see everything that gets downloaded along with Flask. Perfect. Now that our project requirements file is ready, if you want to create a repo for this project and others end up wanting to run your project to check it out, all they'll have to do is download the requirements from this file. If you do want to post this on GitHub, then let's also create a gitignore file. Do new file dot gitignore. And then inside, we don't want this ENV file to be sent up, so I'm going to do ENV. VS Code also creates this folder. We don't need that either. And another good one is PyCache. You might have seen it already when working with Python. It's a file that gets created sometimes, and we don't need that either. And if you're on a Mac, there's also this DS store file that pops up from time to time, and it's specific to Macs. So if you're on a Windows, you don't need to worry about that one, but it's always a good one to ignore. Cool, make sure you save, and then we don't need that file anymore right now. And you're all set to work on this locally. I also posted these steps in the teacher's notes below for reference, along with a resource on virtual environments in case you decide to work locally later on. Again, choose the path that works best for you. I'll have the resources available throughout the course for both local and workspaces-based projects. I'm excited to work on this project with you. So let's get started.